candidates, voters, and the media in order to shift the political paradigm. So that's the first most important thing. And the strategy is obviously to have it simultaneously. So it's held today, this morning in Kuching, in Kota Kinabalu, and also here in KL. So the genesis of this, the origins of why we're doing this today, is the fact that an open letter that was signed on to by several NGOs, and today that amounts to 20 NGOs, was actually released on the 25th of January this year. NGOs coming from here in the peninsula, in Sabah and in Sarawak, that made a call to political parties to recognize the environmental aspirations of the citizens of Malaysia, and especially that of the youth, the young people, the generation of tomorrow, the decision makers of tomorrow, the leaders of tomorrow, the corporate leaders of tomorrow, and of course people that end up in all walks of life that contribute to societal development. So by including these aspirations in their party manifesto, so the call is to ensure that we include environmental concerns in the party manifesto, ensuring that they're given high priority to ensure sustainable development, both for the current and the future generations. So wanting to ensure that we do not take the standard, usual, normal paradigm of development, which is usually often skewed to economic motivations, but to have SD, sustainable development paradigm that looks at, you know, people, of course, profits, and then the planet, you know, so making sure that the balance is there. So the open letter has been prepared in a neutral and non-partisan manner on behalf of our supporters, because all of us in this coalition have got people that support us. But they are the same people who are voters in the various constituencies, and that's the most important thing. So they expect us to engage with the political system to advocate sustainable development and to urge the political parties, the candidates, to make environmental considerations and sustainable development a priority above party politics. So party politics shall remain party politics, important for their own reasons. But our call is to ensure that sustainable development and environmental considerations get embedded irrespective of the political party, the candidates, and where they belong. I mean, fundamentally, we want it to be told that humans cannot survive without nature. And that's just the fact of the matter. While development is meant to increase our standards of living and grow our economy, unsustainable development inadvertently destroys the environment. And it's the same one and the same environment that provides services which we often take for granted, such as clean air, fresh water, food, protection against extreme weather, and so on and so forth. So the goods and services that the environment plays is often understood. Natural capital is often misunderstood or not appreciated. And our call on behalf of the people that support us in our mission, and like I mentioned, they are the same one and the same voters, they expect this to be better managed. So with that little opening, I'd just like to take the chance then to pass the floor on to my colleague to maybe tell us a few more things about what we've been up to.
Yeah, thanks, Dino. Yeah, just a point here to share with you all, and that is, there was an online survey on environmental concerns which was carried out from February to March of this year. There are a total of 1,603 responses to date, and here are the results. 95% of the respondents say they are either concerned or very concerned about the natural environment in general. They are also concerned about the pollution of rivers and seas as the top environmental concern amongst all Malaysians. More than 86% are concerned, followed by deforestation, illegal logging, and more than 84% of these have expressed their concern in those areas. So there you see the results of that survey, and in total, I would say that almost 61% are very concerned, and 34% express they are being concerned about it, and another 5% slightly concerned. So in total, you almost have 100%, almost 100% expressing certain different levels of concern for the areas that I've just mentioned. So with that, I would like to pass on to my colleague, Nidhi, who will take us through the other part here. Nidhi, please.
So I'll be touching on the... I'll be touching on the response to the environmental topics which the respondents are most concerned about. And the top, as Henry had mentioned earlier, 86%, the highest ranking issue was the pollution of the rivers and seas. And yet, there was a very high concern for a broad range of environmental issues across the board. So more than 80% of the respondents are equally concerned with these three topics, loss of parks, forests, beaches, natural areas to development, which was highlighting the point which was made by Dino just now. Rubbish, not properly managed or not recycled. And climate change, you know, which is manifesting through global warming and extreme weather events. Yet at the same time, so these were the issues which, you know, garnered more than 80% of the respondents expressed serious concern about. Yet, even if you look at the broad range of other environmental issues, all of which had a ranking of more than 60%, you know. So whether you take hunting, whether you take air pollution, haze, overfishing, all these environmental issues are of great concern to the respondents. So this is a snapshot of the results. Now I will hand over to Krista to talk about whether the environment will influence respondents to vote differently.
Thank you very much, Nidhi. Yes, so again, the survey showed us very interesting information that 93% of the people who were surveyed have actually said that they will definitely or likely to consider the environment as a factor when they're voting. So that's close to 100% of people are most certainly or are most likely going to take the environment into consideration when they're voting. So this is a very important demonstration of the people's concern. And then also another interesting point is, as we're going into the campaign period, we hope that the political parties will make note of another result from the survey is that 84% of the people who are surveyed said they want to learn more from the political parties about what is that particular party's aspirations and goals to protect the environment. So again, we said we hope during the campaign period, the political parties will address this and will talk to the people about their concerns and how we're going to make Malaysia better and more sustainable as we go. And I just think it's important to note also that if you've not had a chance to participate in the survey, it's not too late. The survey is still open. So we are welcoming the public because the more the public participates, the more these political parties can see how important it is to the voters. And we really hope that this will be reflected in the campaign period, and not just in the campaign, but in the aftermath, once governments are formed, how they start implementing their policies on the ground. So please do, we'll share the website again in a bit, and if you haven't yet, please do make sure you complete the survey and participate. So I'll pass it back now to Dr. Dino, who will bring us back.
Thank you so much, and we'll pass it to Faiz first.
Lastly, let us watch a short video which features the voices of young Malaysians from different backgrounds and their aspirations for G40, and see how many languages you can write.
This GE, I vote for healthy forests. Undiono, recycle bag. Tidak mau plastik. நமது எதிர்காலத்திற்கான சிறந்த நகர்ப்புற திட்டமிடல் தேவை.
you. Thank you for your attention. It's a very short video. We'll share it on our social media channels today. So, yeah, the floor is now open for questions for the media. Do you have any questions to ask? Would you have any questions about how did the open letter come about?
Since we went around and tried to find to form a coalition, there were a bit less, but it's now gone up to 20, and the new inclusions are actually so the 19th one is Sarawak Eco Warriors, and the 20th one is Hunger Hurts. Who's right here? No. Good. And Brave Volunteers. I think now that we know exactly when we have to go to poll and hopefully cast our votes, we know how we would like to see what sort of government being formed. We have had the announcements about how things will happen, right? The challenge now remains between now and actual voting, right? So how candidates from all political parties will take up environmental aspirations of the country. I mean, our survey is indicative, if at all. It's a sample size. Most surveys are a smaller sample size, but it's indicative of what people aspire. I think there's been a lot that we've seen, we've read in the last so many years. The issues on, you know, flash floods because of inability of forests to contain water, because there's so much less forest to contain water. So water surface runoff is high. We've seen extreme weather, for example. We know of water shortages in many states, water stress states. We even know that some states have to have inter-water basin transfers. You know, dams are being built. Biodiversity loss. We hear of a lot of species that are down to the last few numbers. So I think it is now the time for the voters, when they make their votes, to look out and listen to the candidates. What are the candidates saying in terms of how they commit and pledge to do something sincere and serious about environmental matters? That will matter most. So at the end of the day, we are a coalition that has tried our best to bring together people through a poll, a vote, to see what their concerns are. We've shared with you the statistics. Actually, the ball is in the court of voters. They will then now listen out to the candidates and make judgments for themselves who has the best chance to promise us a brighter future with regard to sustainable development. Anybody wants to?
Also, to add on to that, you're saying what impact it will have. And I think the impact for politicians is usually very much driven by what the voters want. And you can see that from the response of the survey, they have very high regard for the environment and the whole broad range of environmental issues. And it is, I think, very pertinent for politicians to respond to, react to the fact that this is a high priority issue amongst the voters.
Thanks, Dino. One point that I'd like to share is that as NGOs, you know, conservation NGOs, what we do is to raise consciousness amongst the public. In this case, because the timing of our general elections around the corner, and to highlight some of those issues about the environment that invariably actually affects us and also the future generation. So therefore, I think by bringing that awareness to the voters and the public, they become more conscious and more aware of what they should be looking at. Because sometimes we read about certain aspects of conservation when we're affected. Let's say our home get affected with a shortage of water. But then we start to plan, you know, we start to complain, that's too late. So it's good that with that consciousness, they are able to then present questions, to ask questions in, to their politicians who are, you know, covering their area or their constituency as to what they're going to do about it. You know, because that is going to be the question that you do not want to have to face 10 years, 5 years down the track. So that's where we are at. We are generally, I would like to state that we are generally apolitical. We are not affiliated to any political parties. But as NGOs, we have the responsibility. Conservation NGOs, we have the responsibility to highlight, to share, and also to advocate some of these issues that concerns our environment going forward. Thank you.
Thanks. I think that's a very, very pertinent and valid question. Eh? But like I tried to allude earlier, actually the judge is going to be the people, the rakyat. So the manifestos out there, but the voters who took part in this poll, the voters who even have not taken part, by the way, the survey is still alive, they will have to read what the manifestos contain. They will have to be the best judge as to how they believe the manifestos will translate into actions. And I think that's the way it will work in any elections manifesto. We have to leave it to the powers of the people to decide what works best for them in their minds.
I think also that during the campaign period, as we have mentioned, we really do hope also that the political parties will be able to elaborate further what they put in their manifesto and how they will translate that into action so that people have an understanding. So we hope to see that happen also.
So, for the top concern of the survey, which the pollution of Rio and
I don't think at this point we want to make any suggestions to any candidates in terms of what exactly they need to do. I think the point really is that knowledge is abundant. I mean, nowadays you can just about go anywhere and you can find information, you can find knowledge, and you can use that to take necessary actions, to formulate policies and then figure out laws to regulate polluters and all kinds of things that can be done. And a lot of developed countries, for example, those are the indicators. A sustainable and functioning environment is really an indicator that we're providing the bedrock for social development, the bedrock for economic development, and the bedrock to ensure that planetary services, ecosystem services continue. So at this juncture, we're not going to make any specific recommendations of what needs to be done. That really is a level playing field for any candidate, party, to figure out what needs to be done, because we have actually seen a lot of damages happening, and it's not for us to propose, to suggest, to recommend specifics, but rather to encourage that these be taken up. So the pollution of rivers and seas, so the waterways are obviously of concern to Malaysians, because if you go down to KL, you'll see polluted the Gombak, the Klang rivers, or you travel around the country, you see rivers badly silted up, right? Because of obviously activities of deforestation and logging upstream, or even agriculture. You go around the coastal areas, tourism sites, you see so much of marine trash all over the place. Marine pollution, marine plastics is a big issue. So these things are common knowledge, just what everybody knows these things, right? And then secondly, there seems to be high concern about loss of forest cover, deforestation. Again, all you need is just drive around the country and you'll see all these activities going on. They're a part of the economy. They're part of a way we generate income for national capital. But I think the concerns Malaysians has is, will that stop? Will that be better managed? Can it be sustainably managed? Can it be certified? Can activities of national capital extraction be certified in a sustainable way? No? So these are the things that the voters would have to ask, those tough questions, and the candidates, the parties would have to devise ways that convince people that these are the right things to do. So translate the readily and publicly available information and knowledge into tangible and reasonable and reliable actions that people will feel confident, and then, of course, as we say, will cast their vote in the right direction. My colleagues may have some other opinion.
Thank you.
more than, I think what the survey also showed is that more than all the individual, the specific issues which have been highlighted, just shows that there's a great concern for the whole broad range of environmental issues. You know, every issue is of concern to the voter, and I think that's the main point which has been highlighted by the survey.
For the first question that's
now,
do you have any timeframe for the top leadership to respond on the
opinion? We would, of course, want to have an immediate reaction, if possible. But I think, given the busy period, you know, we will have to need time. So we'll allow time. I think a reasonable time would be, say, within the next 30 days or so, if possible, that they could come back and maybe make a public announcement that says that what are they planning to do about some of the the environmental issues. And on that, I just want to follow up on what Dr. Dino had just mentioned about sustainability. I think it's all about sustainability, all about sustaining everything that we do, be it deforestation, be it felling of trees, be it industrial development. I think there's a general thinking, perhaps amongst the commercial side of things, that NGOs, conservation NGOs, are always against them about development. But we like to just correct that impression to say that NGOs are not against the development, but NGOs are or advocate against non-sustainable development. You know, if the sustainability of development is taken care, then I think it benefits everybody. You know, it benefits now, it benefits the future. So you hear less from the NGOs. We'll be happy not to advocate about all these issues. You know, then we'll have no issues to advocate. But so many things are happening that are not following the principles of sustainability. So that's what we keep voicing up. You know, so we don't want to be seen as the bad guys. Yeah, we want to be seen as the people who would like to balance up that unsustainable development that's happening around us. Thank you.
And I think also to answer your question or to elaborate a bit further on when we'd like to see a response, I know Henry had mentioned 1 month, but I think in the next 2 weeks they have their campaign period. So I think in these next 2 weeks we want to see, I mean, as NGOs, we want to see this, but more we're asking on behalf of the community, the rakyat, they need to know and they're concerned. So in the next 2 weeks, over this campaign period, we would like to see these issues properly addressed.
Earlier
than that.
Sooner than that. Okay, please.
Any more questions? Thank you so much. It's a good debate. It's a good discussion. Before we wrap up, I would like to invite each of you to pick up your mobile phone. If you have a Twitter account, just log into your Twitter or otherwise Facebook account. Let us now think of at least one environmental issue in your mind now. Please tweet or post about the environmental issues of your concern and hashtag with Vote for Environment GE14 Malaysia. We sincerely hope that mainstreaming environmental agendas